The humble citizen from Chigarama. I keep referring to myself. I was born on the 16th of July 1989 to a very young couple, the late Simon and Topista. My mother, I was told, my mother got married when she was 15.
The 17-year-old.
Yes. And for some reason, because she was still young, she could not conceive immediately. It took time. I think maybe the growth was not yet, you know, proper. After some time, and after medical examination, she was able to get pregnant. Mm-hmm. Then, you know, produced me.
Oh, you were that first.
Yes,
business.
Exactly. So
you came a long time.
Exactly. So when she produced me, I was a very chubby, healthy baby. And she was like, okay, this is something I couldn't believe. I should keep remembering this. So that's how my father called me Chokoranga. Yes. Exactly. So I was born in a village called Chigarama, in Maziba sub-county, Ndolwa East constituency, Kabale district. And that's why I keep telling people that I am a humble citizen from Chigarama. Referring to those humble beginnings, that humble background.
I think my mother loved me. Absolutely, because she got us, having told you how she got married out of school, she was picked from P6 and then she got married, you know, then she took time to have us. She really loved us. And I know that all that she was doing because she wanted me to become an
stand out better than
exactly. Anyone else. And to be honest with you, I regret having lost her at a very young age because I think...
You would have rewarded her.
Yeah. And I think I would even be a much better person. But of course, you know, when you lose parents, then you start, you know, hoping from family to family. You miss the motherly love and parental love.
And that's care. The journey you tell us, especially when you play after playing your first song. Because on the program here, we play our music.
Yeah.
So you play your first song, and then we'll get down to how life was in an orphan situation.
Yeah.
And I want to believe it was a little peasant homestead.
Yeah.
Down there,
yeah,
without much in terms of an income,
yeah,
but how you were able to go through school.
Exactly.
What would be your first song?
My first song would be Dance With My Father.
You want to have a dance with your father?
Yeah, I think about it every time.
What would you tell him in his ear if you had the chance to have a dance with your father?
I would just tell him, thank you for bringing me to this world, because I've had an incredible journey living and meeting people and all of that. And I know for sure, just like you do, it wouldn't have been possible hadn't your father or my father decided to say, let me have a child.
Indeed.
Yeah, and I tell that to my son. I have my firstborn called Calvin.
Mm-hmm.
I tell him always, I'll tell you the story about him later.
But I always tell him
that it's very important and you should love your father.
Well, because you had him
yes.
out of will.
Yeah.
Exactly. You chose
yeah.
one who to have him with,
yeah.
went ahead and had him.
Exactly.
There are circumstances where you may have a child accidentally, more like you're walking on your usual path to church, knock a stone, and down you fall.
And
you wake up, dust yourself. Continue with your journey. That's With My Father, a song by Luther Vandross, chosen by Alexander here in memory of his dad, with whom he certainly did not have quite a lot of time socializing with, but who he's eternally grateful and brought him up. We'll be right back.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
If I could get another chance, another walk, another dance with him, I'd play a song that would never, ever end. How I'd love, love, love.
All right, welcome back from that short break. It's 91.3 Capital FM's Desert Island Discs. My name is Simon Kasiate. Alexander Chokojuka, an author. His book is right here, Personal Finance Mastery. It's a simple guide on how to manage your money. And now we make a lot of it. We hustle to make a lot of it. But oftentimes we don't even know how to manage it. And so when a guy puts down his thoughts, we may need now to ask him how he manages his own money.
Yeah.
So, getting down to this book, you know, yeah. I want to just juggle you out from your life story to some of the things that you're doing.
No problem.
You said you call it a simple guide on how to manage your money, but what's that key thing that one has to do to manage their money? Money, they say cash is king.
Yeah.
Now, when you're dealing with royalty, like cash,
yeah.
it's not easy to manage.
Exactly. Now, one thing is there are three or four things that I will tell you right away that if you want to manage your money better and in a simple way, number one, master the art of generating the income, because you must make the money. No matter how much you make, but you must make it. Whether it is 10,000 or 100,000, you must make it.
That's in dollars, I'm sure you're talking about.
Exactly. No, 10,000, you get the shillings. Now, then the next thing would be managing your spending decisions. How do you make your spending decisions? Is it because you've seen Simon putting on a shoe worth $100,000 and then you say, oh, I think I'll
the diamond studs for its
exactly,
soul.
Exactly. You know, so making those spending decisions is very key, and people need to learn them. The other thing is definitely saving. You don't make money and then you spend and then you think that you're going to make anything if you're not saving.
But then I tell you something, Alexander.
Yes, yes.
Why should I live poor and die rich? That's normally the question I ask when I want to avoid saving.
I'll refer you to the Indian money culture. Mm-hmm. The Indians usually save for the next generation. The money that you're making today, Simon, is not supposed to be enjoyed by you. Mm. It's supposed to be enjoyed by your grandchildren.
Yeah, but if I am starting from scratch, really, I can't subject myself to a lot of hard work.
No.
For the next generation, especially so.
Yes.
I have looked around and seen what children do to their parents' monies, especially after they have gone.
Yeah.
But
of course, it also depends on how you bring them up. If you're saving for them and their children, are you able to tell them to appreciate this kind of effort that you're making, so that then they can take on, you know, the culture and can keep growing like that?
At another time, we'll have a longer conversation around making money, keeping it, saving it, blowing it, and investing it.
Yes.
Back to your life story.
Yes.
At a tender age, you lose your father.
Yeah.
You're just three of you.
Yeah.
Your mother is in the village, the typical woman next door who just wakes up in the morning, comes to her garden.
Yeah.
You hadn't even gone so much into education. You possibly were in a primary one.
Yeah.
In a local primary school.
Chigarama Primary School.
Which is possibly a church school. I've never been
it
there.
It is. Well, it's a normal government school, but you know,
next to church.
Yeah, the church is just across.
With the mud and water floor, yes. Where you had to take cow dung every occasionally just to make the floor.
Exactly.
Where you possibly were sitting on small mats made out of banana fiber. Yeah. And not so much writing exercise books. But if you had exercise books, I'm sure they were the kind that were cut into two.
Yeah.
Pencils cut into four.
And sometimes into three. Into the book would be cut into three. If you're three children, then they would cut
one
into
book
three.
They cut into three.
So that each of you can have a piece.
Now, the one who gets the part which has the name, the design where you have to put the name is the king.
The king,
which must have been you.
Yeah, sure.
Take us through that.
Yeah. So I lose my father when I've just started P1 at Chigarama Primary School. And it didn't mean so much to me at the time because I had no idea what it meant. My mother used to trade in local brew. Tonto. We would make Tonto and she would sell. And that's how
From
we
home?
Yeah, from,
or
yeah,
to
from
the
home.
Town?
From home.
No, so she home would, was a little bar?
No, she would supply. She was a wholesaler.
She was a brewer and distributor.
From our banana plantation, we would get the beer and then we do the tonto and then we supply.
Would you participate in the process?
Yes.
Or how were you
do.
Participating?
At the time, of course, it was only fetching water because that's what I could do.
Opening the ripe bananas.
Yeah, exactly.
Eating half what you open.
Eating half.
And then the other part eating
throwing
the trough.
Exactly. I was unfortunate that I left Chigarama for school before I learned how to do the actual bit of...
Using your feet,
yeah. So because we were still young. So she did that until I came to P4. And P4, I had become a bit more stubborn. So my auntie came and she told her that, you know what, this boy... He's stubborn, he does this and the other. So my auntie asked her, can I take him? And my mother said,
Please.
Save me from this little vagabond. Exactly. So my auntie brought me to Kampala.
Eh?
Yes. And she was a secretary at Makerere University.
So you wake up one morning. Out of being extremely obstinate as a child.
Yes.
And out of stubbornness, an opportunity shows up for you to be whisked away.
I can tell you that morning, I even didn't know I was going to Kampala. Because my auntie came at around 2
a.m.
And while 2 p.m. Mm-hmm. So when they were discussing, I heard my mother say, you take him, at around 3. So they called me. At the time, I had joined my other friends. Mm-hmm. We were going to some hill called Bwanama to fetch... grasshoppers in Senene. So they called me, I came back, they told me, you shower, you bathe, you're going to Kampala. So I bathe, we walk. I remember that time I didn't have a pair, I didn't have shoes, I didn't have sandals, I had nothing. So I on my feet, we went up to Nyanja where we slept, and then the following day we boarded the bus and came to
Kampala. So wait a minute, at what point did you wear your first pair of shoes?
When I went to primary school in Isinjiro, when I was joining P5.
So they first bring you to Kampala, then how do you end up in Isinjiro?
I came to Kampala and then spent some time, and then my auntie was looking for a school for me. Mm-hmm. Got it in St. Joseph's Primary School, Chabirukwa. And
In Isinjiro.
So.
That's very interesting. You should first come to Kampala.
Yes.
They look for a school. Of all the schools gathered here in Kampala,
yes.
They send you back to...
Exactly.
Did you have any relatives in Isinjiro or anything?
No. Yes, we had a relative there. My auntie, my distant auntie, mm-hmm. who is a nun. Mm. She was actually the deputy head teacher of the school.
Of that school.
Yes.
How, considering your levels of stubbornness, they need to take you to a nun school.
Exactly. And I think somewhere, somehow, there was a silent idea of taking me into priesthood to become a priest.
But your mother was also a little bit out of it. You have three boys.
Yes.
No, two actually.
Two.
Now.
Yeah, because then there were two.
And you want subject one to total chastity and celibacy.
But this was not my mother. Mm. This was my auntie.
Your auntie.
Yes, and some other aunt of mine.
Okay, now let's go back to the... Had you ever moved in a car for a distance longer than a kilometer?
Yes, I had. I had. In I think when I was six or five, I was beaten by a dog. Yes, so I remember my father gave me some lady from our village who was coming this side. So the lady, I came with the lady to Kampala, so they took me to Malago for treatment. Yes, so that was my first time to move in a car, coming to Kampala to get treatment. So
coming to Kampala, just picture for us, you know, your impression of the journey. I mean, Kabad is also not a very close place.
Yes.
It's about a minimum of 6 hours on the road.
Yeah.
What's going on in your mind at that particular time?
Well,
Do you even remember that you had a dog bite, or it was just the excitement of a journey?
One thing is, I wasn't sure I was going to get healed, but I was also excited that I was coming to Kampala. Because we had heard of Kampala. Every time my aunt would be coming from Kampala, she would bring us bread, you know, those things. So I knew that I'm going to a place which is a bit better than home.
Where bread is a
step. So I said, okay, let me go get to see how this Kampala is. And I was excited. And we reached here much later in the evening, and I saw
lights,
those things, that those small calabashes that were lighting.
Oh, to you they were calabashes.
Calabashes, my friend.
So extinguishing them was done by her blowing them up.
I had to ask so that I get to know. That's when they told me that's electricity, those are bulbs, and you know those things. Quite like any typical village boy, anyway.
But that's not very long ago. This is recently.
That's not long ago. That was I think around 1996.
But there must have been something that came to your mind. I mean, like, literally speaking, a light bulb possibly was going off in your mind.
Well, it was just one of the very many things, because, you know, the Kampala town, really, and then compare it with the Chigarama village, which was not as advanced as it is today, because now there's electricity in Chigarama. But there was a shift, you know, in what I knew then and what I was here seeing. I was like, okay, these things are also possible.
But it's also a travesty that just around the corner in Chigarama is one of the oldest hydroelectric dams, the Maziba Dam.
Oh, yeah.
And you didn't have electricity.
Exactly.
This is a dam that was commissioned in the 60s.
Yes, and even as I talk, the electricity we have in Chigarama is not from that dam.
Yeah, well.
It is from a recently constructed one.
Wow, that's a very interesting one.
<Yes.
but. laughs> So you go to this primary school in Isinjiro. And start in P5.
Yes.
Cultural change?
Yeah, a lot. Mm-hmm. This was a Muchiga boy, mm-hmm. studying with Banyankole, Bahima, Banyarwanda. And of course, you know the perceptions around our tribes and all that. But I had to muzzle through all of that.
What perceptions? Because for all I know, you possibly are all the same. You speak the same word and it means the same across board.
Anyone
you
will tell you.
You actually behave the same, or so people will think.
Yes, but someone will tell you that if you talk of a Muchiga, someone will know he's very strong, very, you know,
rough
guys and all of that. And it so happened that I had started, you know, growing a bit muscular. And so in the school, you would see these small boys, and then for you are there. They're like, oh, this one, if you talk, they will beat you. Yeah. So I had to muzzle through all of those and more or less up to, I think, P6. That's when I started, when we started feeling, you know, free with each other. Yeah, because most of the time, actually, I used to stay at school and others went to.
Ah, because your aunt, who is the nun and head teacher, was in there.
Exactly.
You were studying. Did you have an idea? Did you have an ambition? Did you have a dream of what you wanted to be?
No.
You were just going through the motions.
I was just going to school. Because for me, it was an opportunity. Like when I went to Chabrukwa, it was just an opportunity that I'm also with some kids of rich people. So for me, I had arrived. I didn't have an idea what was going to happen after P7.
But you were there.
I was there.
Let's play the next song. When we return, you tell us which secondary school then you aspire to join.
Sure. Well, my next song will be We Are the World.
This is the song that was put together by a number of US musicians.
Exactly.
Marshaled by Michael Jackson, exactly. The likes of Lionel Richie and his.
Exactly. It speaks to me because every day I live, I feel I and the rest of us have a responsibility to make this world a better place. We have a responsibility to respond to the challenges that we face every other day and the people and all that. And for me, it really motivates me and speaks to me, especially with my efforts, my little efforts here and there.
Well, let's just forget that the world is a bad place simply because some of us have chosen to make it bad.
Exactly.
Why it makes you think that, again, we are the same people that should make it great and better for others?
Not all of us are bad. Some of us are good. So it can take us, the good ones, to actually change the world and make it
better. Have you checked how many bad people are there
in
comparison to you, the good?
The bad people would be more than the good people.
What makes you think the new good people are able to go against we, the bad ones, make this world a better place?
I can tell you that there's nothing that beats a humble effort with great love, great commitment, and great motivation.
Where do you pick that from? Is that a personal mantra or you've read it somewhere in the book?
A lot. I think also Mother Teresa
says
something close to that. But that's my conviction. And for me, when I pick on something and I'm convinced it's good, I commit to it, motivate myself, and go for it.
You'll agree with me that he's your typical guy next door, but certainly with quite a lot. And like I always argue, you and I have a story to tell. The only thing is we have not been here to tell this story. And when we get the opportunity to have you on the program, we love to listen to those incredible life stories. And let's listen to this wonderful song and be back with the rest of Alexander's story.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
Welcome back. It's Alexander Chokwishka, who is an author, he's an analyst, he is a financial guru, he is a communicator, he's everything and a passionate citizen who prefers to always refer to himself from his humble cradle in his little village town, and he prefers to call himself the little boy from that village. I don't know what it is about you, Bachiga, and always wanting to refer yourselves back to your humble beginnings. I've seen this even from the most prominent that they come. The reason to look back to where they came from. One wonders what then we'll see in the next years when we start having generations of you being born in Toronto, New York, and other places.
I think a thing about us is that we are original and authentic. So we always want to keep ourselves. Look at Shaka Sally.
Isn't that
so many years?
Isn't that, and the accent has never changed.
Exactly.
I've only done this program a few years, and as you can see, I'm struggling to have an American accent.
I know.
And that's why I was saying, I think you are using a white paintbrush to paint your people. Are they all the same?
They are.
Really?
Majority of them, yeah.
Ah, great. You leave this school that you were tucked away in, in a humble, now district called Isinjiro. Where do you go after that?
I went to St. Joseph's Secondary School, St. Joseph Vocational School in Mbarara.
Which is just along the same road.
Exactly.
Literally, you never left that side of town.
When I was in P6, let me take you back a little. When I was in P6, my auntie, the nun, tricked me into filling forms to go to Mushanga Preparatory Junior Seminary to start on my journey to become a priest.
Oh?
Yes. So, but I really didn't feel it. So
why? It's important to know why you never felt like being a priest.
I did not.
Priests are the guys that always had cars.
Let me tell you something.
I ate well.
I was an altar boy. Mm-hmm. I was doing all these things in church, mm-hmm. but I didn't feel I wanted to become a priest. At that age, I didn't. At least it was the least that I expected myself to become. So I decided to fill the
form. Again, I want to ask why.
I don't know, but I just didn't feel it. Mm-hmm. It wasn't anywhere in my ambition. Or
I find that strange.
Yes. So whereas very many others were dying to have the chance, mm-hmm. but they couldn't get it. But me, I did not, you know. So I made sure I filled the forms wrongly so that they don't call me. Then they brought the forms for St. Joseph's, because St. Joseph's Primary School Chabirukwa and St. Joseph's Vocational School Mbalala were both Catholic church founded, and they were run by the Catholic Church. Mm-hmm. So there was that relationship. So for the St. Joseph's, I filled the forms.
Correctly.
Yeah, correctly. Yeah, that one I couldn't go. So they called us for interviews, and then I went and passed the interviews, and I got senior one.
I thought they admit on the basis of PLE. They have to do interviews.
You have to do interviews. Whether you passed PLE or you excelled or you got just average, mm-hmm. you are subjected to interviews.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So you get in there.
I get in there. And the usual story, the village boy, and there are some others from the high end. And of course, you know, you get that shock. But you say, oh, I'm here for school. And you try as much as you can to fit in. I got into basketball and started playing.
The Muchiga boy
playing basketball without shoes.
And not to say that you are well gifted in terms of height. Here you are.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So some of those things.
What dragged you to basketball as opposed to football and other muscle needing sport?
Like wrestling, javelin? Yes. When I was in Chigarama, I got attacked by jiggers when we were young.
Okay.
So ultimately, mm-hmm. my feet could not play football.
Was it such a bad attack that you had?
Yes, it was a bad attack. Mm-hmm. I don't know. That today, even when I go to the village, those who know my childhood, they want to see, you know, if
that your feet are.
Exactly. So I couldn't play football. So when I reached St. Joseph's, I realized there was basketball, and maybe that's the only thing I could play because I could use my hands. So
well, it could have been lawn tennis.
Well, those were not there. At least you can be sure that it's also not. It's not the high end, you know, school of today. So I got to get a bit famous because of basketball, and also in school and all of that, and it was. I think by around senior two, Chokujuka was a household name in the school.
You could dunk away.
Oh, yeah.
Send a three-pointer from the distance.
Exactly.
Spin the ball on your finger.
Uh-huh. Those small things you do, and then people are like, this guy has magic. Yeah.
If only they knew that your feet were only just surviving in there.
I know.
Again,
yeah.
At this point in time, you haven't yet realized what your calling is in life.
I think around the senior three, we had a discussion with my auntie who was sponsoring me. And she told me that, you see, your father was, I took your father to be, by the way, that my auntie is the one who educated my father. So she was doing it partly to fulfill what she had wanted to see my father. Mm-hmm. So she told me, you see, your father had just finished primary teacher's college and then he got sick and died. So I am. Want you to, after senior four, you go to a primary teacher's college, become a teacher. You'll be sure you have a job and you'll become rich. Say, my level of ambition was really so low, so I didn't have an idea what else I was supposed to do.
She told you?
Yes.
That you'd go to a primary teacher's college?
Yes.
Graduate as a teacher?
Yes.
Get a job on a assured level?
Yes.
And then
make money.
The big lie came in.
Yes.
You'd become rich.
I know.
When you're looking at the guys teaching you in your class, do you see rich people?
No, because the teachers in the village, mm-hmm. they are rich.
Oh.
They are the rich people that you can see, you know. So I knew that. And after senior four, I remember when results came, and I was here. We were here in Makerere. So a family friend came and then asked me, that, hey, you, the rest are at school. What are you doing here? I said, me, I'm also supposed to go to school, but we have not yet time has not yet come. Said, where are you going? Said, I'm going to Gaba PTC. Huh? Asked me, what did you score? I told him. Said, okay. And with those good grades, and you want to take them to a PTC? My auntie was in the kitchen listening. Mm-hmm. So she jumped out. She was like, yes.
Yes.
I don't have the money to take him to A-level. So I'm taking him to PTC. PTC. So the guy looked at me, looked at my auntie, and then he was like, no, let's find a school. I'll pay for him.
What?
For A-level, yes. So his kids were in St. Joseph's Nagarama. So he said, we shall get for him place, and then we shall pay for him. I got excited. Mm. 1 week, 2 weeks, senior five students reported.
Okay.
3 weeks, I was still at home.
Mm-hmm.
So at the time, I was helping my auntie in the Komamboga. She was constructing. So I was helping out as a porter.
Mm-hmm.
So one day she came and I had just, you know, this 99, this big box?
Yes.
99.
Yes.
I was carrying it, you know, lifting it and giving it to the builder, you know, on a ladder, and then you climb with it and stuff like that. So I had pushed like 10 and I was feeling my back, you know, aching and all that. So she came and phoned when I was just mixing sand, and then I stood and she realized I was tired. So she came and asked me, Alex, if I found you a school, I'm saying the right words, a school, can you go for A-level and sit and study? I said, that's what I've been waiting for. She said, because this guy was telling you things he could not do because he thought I could not manage. So I said, thank God. The next week, she came and told me, we've got you a mission school, St. Charles Ruanga Senior School, Kasasa.
Wow.
In Kalung, in the rest, in
Kalungu
the
district.
Kalungu district, that you go and study. Now, Simon, if there's anything I want to tell you on this show, and forget about the rest. The day that we set off going to Kasasa, I carried my suitcase on my head. My auntie carried my mattress on her head. And we walked from Makerere to Makerere. I don't know whether it's true, she didn't have the money, but she told me she didn't have the money. We walked with my suitcase on my head.
Like every Muchiga.
Yeah. Every Muchiga would do. With my mattress
even
on do,
so even when you're in a bus.
Exactly. So we walked up to Makerere small gate.
Mm-hmm.
We got taxi and went to town to jump on the taxis to Masaka. I went. When I reached the taxi park, there was a taxi conductor who said that Mufuka, Olaba mama wo watu yanye. I said yes. Agamba, kendo some.
Wow.
Those words.
Mm.
I went up to Masaka.
I'll do a ring in your head.
Until I left Masaka after my senior six. I still remember those words. And I think they were my biggest. Unfortunately, I cannot get that guy. I don't know where I can get him. I don't even remember how he looks like.
He possibly ain't also remember you.
Exactly.
And there's something about taxi toads.
Yeah.
They will give you the worst insult that will get you out of this world.
Exactly.
They were the most annoying people.
Exactly.
But again, like in your case,
yeah,
they will give you that word of inspiration that will keep you as wind beneath your wings for the rest of your life.
Exactly.
Whether or not they leave what they say, but at least they say what keeps you going. Taxi toad looked at your mother.
Yes, in his sweating, eye, with a mattress on her head, with a suitcase on my head. And man, for the 2 years I was in A-level, that was my biggest point of motivation.
What were you studying in your A-level?
I studied history, economics, divinity, and literature in English.
So, with the words of the taxi toad ringing in your mind every day, what did you want to be?
I wanted to become a lawyer.
Not a teacher
anymore. At that time,
anymore.
Not a teacher anymore. But the funny thing is that my auntie had not yet dropped the dream
idea
of me becoming a teacher. So she told me, you finish in your seat, go to an NTC.
Hey, now we had upgraded.
Hey, upgraded
from
now.
A PTC now to an NTC.
So I studied all the same, but in my mind, I love, especially when I started studying literature, My literature teacher, Mr. Severi Wakrisostomy, he's so rest in peace. He kept telling me, you guys are the next lawyers. And man, I got interested. I was like, I'm going to become a lawyer. And so in senior five, that's when I get into student leadership.
Let me just ask.
Yes.
For a woman that subjected you to walking with your suitcase on your head for a distance of not less than 7 kilometers.
Yeah.
Would I be wrong to say that when you left, parted ways,
yeah,
she left you with nothing, if at all, for pocket money?
That's a different story. I usually joke with my wife when I tell her that, for instance, I always had around 10,000 shillings for pocket money for a whole term, and she laughs at me like that. That was like that was like money for grub for just 2 days, a day or something. But I never took it in bad faith, because I knew, even when she could have been having the money, I knew that she was preparing me for life.
So for you, you survived on the strictly provided school meals?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
You never missed a single morning, a single day from the dining?
You survive and you're off with your life, because by the time lunch comes, you'll have said.
So you were the permanent fixture in the dining hall?
Absolutely. Very disciplined and very good at timekeeping, yeah. Because you have to keep time. And only that, there is something that I found in St. Joseph's that I don't see in many schools. When it was meal time, you know, at St. Joseph's, they would allocate you tables. So we knew Simon, Solomon, Alex, you know, Josh, 12 of you, you're on table 12. Yes. So when it is meal time, you all will gather at the dining and wait for the dining to be opened. All of you go to your table and wait for the table leader. There's a table leader who must come and serve everyone. And you don't touch the plate until the table leader has finished.
Usually the table leader is chosen how? Is it the smallest guy around that you use as a houseboy?
No.
Or is it the big guy that acts like the father?
When they allocate you the table, you meet the first day and elect a table leader. It was that democratic in St. Joseph.
Wait a minute. So the first day of their election day, yes, right in front of a meal.
Exactly. And if the boys knew you as one who likes eating, or you know, or you can kubuza them, they would easily not watch you.
What was the term limit of being
1 year?
1 year table leader. Did you at any one time ascend the leadership of your table?
I did not.
Why? On what grounds? Because you loved to eat.
I was huge, so you.
This guy
would just not do justice to us.
You'd serve the porridge in a jerry can, exactly, as opposed to putting it in a cup. Wow, that's very interesting.
So it somehow taught us the values of fairness, the values of, you know, discipline, honesty, and openness, and most of those. I have not seen it in many schools. So at the end of the day, us, the permanent fixtures,
would
get justice, fairness, served at its best.
Literally.
Yes.
Let's pray your next song. When you return, we now see how then your ambition to become a lawyer,
yes,
is squatted.
Yeah.
How you don't end up in an NTC.
Yeah.
And then you end up doing stuff like this, I mean, finance, mastery, and everything in between.
Yeah. So my next song, there's a song called Singasi Muchara.
Singasi Muchara.
And I dedicate it to my auntie, Madame Rose Wajagasha.
She's alive.
Yeah, she's still alive.
Is she happy with you today?
Yeah. That's a different story, because I think she really wanted me to do other things. Either become a teacher or something. Mm-hmm. And then, so if I should say, I am not sure whether she's happy with what I do now.
But at least you are not dependent on her.
Exactly.
At least she knows that you're able to provide for yourself.
Absolutely.
And those around you.
Exactly.
You are not a burden to her anymore.
Yes. So I dedicate her a song, Singasi Muchara, because if it had not been for her, honestly, I don't know where I would be. I don't know how my life would be today.
I'll be asking you maybe off the camera what it is that you have done to reward her beyond just being useful to yourself. But that's a story for another day. We'll be right back. It's Desert Island Discs.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
Independent woman, African woman. Muchara. Singa si muchara,
singa sa kuma,
singa
singa sa iga,
singa si mambo we,
singa sa kula,
singa.
Welcome back. It's Desert Island Discs. Still having this conversation with Alexander Chokishka, who is everything a young man can be, 31 years of age, complete with a family, running businesses, teaching, running a daytime job, and hustling through life as they all do. And for that reason, we said, come on, how are you able to juggle all the things in a 24-hour cycle for a day where many, in fact, the cry and hue from people your age is that there is unemployment.
Yeah.
Josh, do you believe it's a case of unemployment, a case of unemployability, or a case of sheer laziness where we sit on our laurels and expect things to just be delivered to us?
All of that you have mentioned. So, to some, they have the skills, but they can't get the job.
Why can't they?
Because the jobs are not readily available. Mm-hmm. So you must have to do something more than just looking for the job.
Like knowing people.
Exactly.
In the right places.
Exactly. So the skills that they have are only just the technical skills, but the skills like interpersonal skills that can help them, you know, network with people, they don't have them. And unfortunately, there are not many places here in Uganda where those skills are taught. Talk about our education system. Yeah.
But I think it also comes down to family. I think we also don't teach our children to be confident.
Yes, because
we shield them so much. Yeah. We give it to them all on a silver platter.
Oh, yeah.
And so we don't prepare them for the life
of course. And also our background and perceptions. I mean, I've told you, for all the life I was in school, someone out there thought I should become a teacher. And she's the one who was paying my fees. So. And indeed, I became a teacher.
Eventually. Well, my mother always wanted me to wear a white lab coat and have a stethoscope around my neck and move around the corridors of Mulago saving lives.
Uh-huh.
The only contribution I've done to that is send people to Mulago by stressing the hell out of them.
I know.
So, National Teachers College dream.
Yeah, shattered.
Why?
When I failed? When I finished A-level,
mm-hmm.
I got 16 points. I failed literature and I got an O. I was there with my dream of becoming a lawyer, you know, in balance, because I wasn't sure now what to do. Makere University could not take me, because if I had to, the only university that teaches law then was Makere University. So when I finished my A-level exams, I came to Kampala. So I told my auntie, I want to look for a job. I want to start working.
So she at the construction site.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
So she told me, okay, we shall find the job. So one day I had just dropped my Punjab form at school. And then I meet a boy who was my deputy head prefect at school.
Were you a head prefect?
Yes, I was a head prefect.
At Kasasa?
Yes, at Kasasa.
Wow, you went into student leadership?
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
So I meet the boy, he was carrying stuff, he was carrying shirts, carrying, you know, socks, those things, men stuff, men wear. So I asked him, so what do you do? He said, I'm a sales executive. Yeah? Hear the word, sales executive. Where? There was a place, I forget the name, in Wandegare. So he said, we sell. So I said, so what do you do? How do you earn money? He said, we sell, they give us stuff, we sell, then we make money. They tell us the limit, and then we sell much more and we make profit. I said, oh, okay, can you take me there? He said, come, we go. At the time, around 4:30, he was actually taking back stuff that had not sold that day. He was taking back to office.
Mm-hmm.
So I went. So when he reached, he took me, and then I saw the lady at the reception. He told her that this guy wants a job. He said, oh, okay, so come back tomorrow, and then you will see what you can do. So when I was just doing that, then the manager was getting out. So he saw me, said, young man, how are you? I said, I'm fine. He said, so what are you looking for? I said, I want a job. He said, oh, you want a job? I said, yes. He said, come back tomorrow at 10 for interviews. So I go home. I tell my auntie, you know what?
I'm getting a job.
They've called me for an
job.
Interview.
Yes. A sales executive.
So the following day, I had my black trouser with its waistcoat, which I had purchased for Sosh.
For Sosh.
And I had my white shirt. So I ironed them very well. Tomorrow, ready for the job interview. So the following day I went, very early. So I reached the place at around 10 minutes to 10. So when I reached that Wandegeya, I found a line of young people, you know,
to that place.
To that place. So when I saw them, in my mind I was like, okay, these ones, they cannot be going for the same interview that I'm going for. So I just said, excuse me. And I moved until the office. So when I reached there, I found there. Of course, the line was...
You were still, hey, was terminating.
Exactly. So the line, these guys were all coming for the job, the same job that I had come for. So the gentleman saw me and said, oh, yes, my friend, please come in. I was very smart. He said, oh, you're very smart. I said, thank you. He said, you get the job.
He just said, you get the job.
Yes. Which job? I did not know. So he told me, so you're going to join our sales executive team, mm-hmm. and you'll be saying stuff like that. You come back on Monday, and then we talk about the details. You come with a letter, an LC1 letter. I went very excited. So I reached home. My aunt was not there. In the evening, she came, and I told her, you know what? I want a letter from the LC. Speaking very confidently, by the way. You know what? I have a job. She asked me, so which job is it?
Sales executive.
She said, oh, okay. So what are you going to be selling? I told her, shirts, socks. So she asked
me. Underwear.
So she asked me, so how much are you going to be paid? I said, no. They actually don't pay us. We pay ourselves.
Juvenile confidence.
They give you stuff, you go and sell. They tell you 10,000, you can sell at 20, and you take 10,000. She looked at me with that kind of an eye. So she was like, in Ruchiga, she was like, Mana wanje was a korobutembe.
This is saying, my son, you are out to go and do hawking.
Hawking. Now, my dreams were shattered. I was going to see myself going to become rich. Now here is someone trying to pour cold water on my foot. Now, immediately, she made a decision and said, you know what? On Monday, I'm going to look for transport, go to the village. There you can get jobs to teach.
Aha! Her ambition of you.
So
that lady wanted to give you what in my current world we refer to as dignified and fulfilling work.
Exactly.
Not talking.
Not talking. So on Monday, I was on the bus to Kabale. So I go to Kabale, get a job in some school, teach English and CRE. Then immediately they made me head of department for English.
Was it primary school?
It was a secondary school.
Wow.
So I was teaching senior 3 and senior 4. Mm-hmm. Then after 2 weeks, I got another job in another school. These two schools were headed by one person. So I was teaching in two schools. They were paying me 50,000 per month each. So I was earning 100,000 per month. Very rich. So I did
which
that.
Which year was this?
This was 2010.
Here, recently?
Yes.
100,000, you are very rich.
Oh, very rich.
Because you were staying at home?
Yes, I was staying. No, I was staying at an auntie's home.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
You had never gone back to Mm-mm. Chigarama, Mm-mm. where?
I last stayed in Chigarama when I was in my P7 vacation. Because the following year, my mother died.
So what's in Chigarama for a home for you?
There is an abandoned house and an unfinished one that I'm putting up.
Without anybody living in that space?
Well, I have a few caretakers who live around, who just come and work on, you know, the farm and a few things. Yes.
Wow, that's an interesting one.
Mm-hmm.
Take us back to your richness of 100,000.
100,000. So, when results came, I am in Kabanyonyi, where I was teaching. I meet a gentleman who I knew was a relative, but I didn't know what kind of relationship we had.
Mm.
So he says, oh, so you are there. You are the son of Simon Wateges. I said, yes. He said, my brother Charles would be very glad to know that you are around. So Charles is a distant uncle who teaches in the UK.
Wow.
Charles spent the biggest part of his life when he was at St. Joseph's Vocational School studying with my father. When my father was a Mupakasi in Mbarara, you know, Kasanyarazi. He was working, I think, in Nifra, something like that.
Mm.
So, the gentleman gives me Charles's email address. The following day, I picked a bicycle, went to Kabare in town. I opened an email address, which I had never had. I sent Charles an email. So that day, I sent my first email in my life.
You remember the day?
I don't remember the date.
But we can go back. I mean, we can. Is that email address still subsisting today?
It must have been
a Yahoo mail or a
Gmail. No, it was a Gmail. Uh-huh. But I think later I lost it because I think I've opened like several of them thereafter.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. So I sent him an email. I told him, I am so and so. I'm son of the late Simon Batajeza. I sent him my phone number. And I went back to Karweru, where I was staying. In the evening, at around 8 p.m., I received an international call.
The first?
Oh!
In your life?
You're joking.
You sat or you
stood? I saw the phone.
Plus four.
Ha! I ran. Because, you know, in the village, you have to run and get a place
where the network
is clear. So by the time I reached...
It was off.
I didn't know whether to call back. I didn't know what to do. I just sat there looking at the phone. Good enough. After like 2 minutes, the guy called again. I picked. Said, hello, this is Charles. Said, nice to meet you. Nice to hear from you, Charles. Said, so you are Simon Batajeza's son? I said, yes, I'm the firstborn. He was like, I'm very excited to see you. He started telling me about my father, so many things. And I can assure you, the little I know about my father
was from that phone call
and the subsequent conversations we had. Because that guy knows my father. They were together. My father was there for him when he needed him. So he tells me so many things about my father that I did not know. So that day he asked me, what are you doing? I said, I'm in vacation, results have come, but I'm teaching in the village. So he asked me, are you not going to university? I said, well, I'm supposed to go to NTC.
Mm-hmm.
He said, why? I said, my auntie, we agreed I'm supposed to go and become a teacher. He said, for you, what would you want to do? I said, I want to do law. He said, law? I said, but so what is the problem? I said, number one, Makerere University cannot take me on government sponsorship. I don't have money for private sponsorship, so I don't have an option. So he said, you don't have to go to Makerere University. Told me, I have connections in Nairobi University. You can go there and do law.
Let's play your next song.
My next song will be Kachumbari.
Why? I mean, this is interesting.
I like the song because it has a touch of creativity and innovation.
Do you listen to this music for its lyrical value? Do you dance?
I'm not the typical guy that goes to club and dances, but I'm a guy who listens to a song and I pick a few things that I like about it.
So what do you like about Kachumbari?
The creativity. Because I know the Kachumbari.
Or the lyrics.
I know the Kachumbari, the actual Kachumbari. So when I had Kachumbari, I had to listen to the song and I liked it. It's a good one. I think the art is really on point. It was someone thought about it and came up with the song.
Interesting. A way to wind down on a Sunday evening listening to a nice song that will get you on your feet. As chosen by Alexander here as he continues to share with us his life story. We'll be right back. Stay with us.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
I said, David, she tell me about your Kachumbari. Chavanyiri awati. Missy wati. Kanavakarusi, alami kanavar mezoli, savani rilawati, misi wati, oh ya pulava kuwa yo ya kayaga in your body.
All right, we continue with our conversation with Alexander here, who is sharing with us an interesting life story. You know, there are some things you just cannot run away from, especially if your fate is to be something. Alexander here tried so hard to run away from the teaching profession. But at least from the last segment, he had been admitted at university to study, guess what? Education.
So I studied education.
Mm-hmm.
Second year, I piqued interest to run for guild president.
Mm-hmm.
But somewhere, somehow, I faced the biggest disappointment of my life when the colleagues I was
counting on
told me, we cannot give you a UID ticket because you are a Muchiga and you'll be hard to sell.
And UID was the thing that was
the thing. So my dreams to become a guild president were shattered. I decided to go back and become president of College of Education External Studies, commanding more than 2,000 students. Mm-hmm. Very powerful. So I leave campus, do my second school practice at Makere College School. Mm-hmm. Little did I know I was tying a rope around my neck. So when I tell my aunt that I'm going to do my school practice at Makere College School, she told me, you are going to keep in Mitchell Hall. Remember, I had finished the course, mm-hmm. but she paid money in Mitchell Hall that I keep there, sleeping there.
Yeah, because she didn't want you to leave.
Exactly. Mm. So when I am finishing school practice and then students are coming back, mm-hmm. the warden calls me. Said, hi, students are coming back. You need to arrange to leave the room. I didn't know what to do. I called my auntie and then she told me, okay, we'll see what to do. But remember, the warden is on my neck. Mm. I had, in second year, I had started rearing pigs in Kawempe.
At whose land?
A friend's land. Mm-hmm. I attended one workshop and they gave us allowance of 100,000. And I went and used the 100,000 to buy two piglets and then put them at a friend's home. Mm-hmm. And I was rearing them from there. So when my auntie told me that, she said, I think what you do, you are going to come here home for 6 months. I will host you for 6 months as you see what to do. the folks at Makere College had promised me a job. So I knew that in 6 months I'll have got money to rent. So after 2 days, she calls me and she's like, okay, you know what? The structure is where I thought you would sleep is where I'm going to sleep because this big house, we are going to put it down. So there's no longer room for you here. They wanted to build a better one.
Wow.
Yeah, so there's no room for you here. I said, what? What do I do? So I went and sold my pigs. By that time, I had around 6 of them. Mm-hmm. They were big. So I sold the pigs, went and looked for a small room.
How much did you get?
I got money that was, I think, around 1.4. So I went to Kawala, paid rent for 6 months for a small room. And then I bought a few things. Remember, I was in the hall of residence. Mm-hmm. I didn't have a bed. I didn't have nothing. So I bought a few things for home and I started life. That was 2013. 2014 January, I graduate. When I graduated, before I graduated, I have a friend of mine called Olivia Mugabirwe. She was my lecturer at university. We became friends. So she asked me to go and help the son who had organized a drug awareness activity in Nakawa at MDAC. So when I went there, I was the MC. So I meet a gentleman called George Tumwesije. George Tumwesije was the executive director of MDAC. So after the event, you know, when after the event you were talking and then the gentleman asked me, so what's your name? I told him, what do you do? He said, I've just finished school, I'm still finishing school practice at Makere College. So he said, oh, I like you. Thank you, you did well. So when I heard that from a person who had the potential to give me a job, said, okay, so sir, how can one work here? He asked me, so what did you study? I said, I studied education, history, and the CRE. Then he said, now, young man, the only thing you can do here is to become a chaplain. Because here we teach business and management.
But you are not a reverend.
I'm not, exactly. So I said, okay, so if that's the case, maybe let's see what...
But I think there's quite a lot of humor out there.
Yes, exactly. So he told me, but let's see what we do. Come to my office on Tuesday, and then we talk. So when I came to his office on the following week, he looked at me. So he asked me, so tell me about yourself. So I told him, he said, you know what I was going to do? Whereas there's nothing you can teach here, but I want to help you to be able to teach here. So he gave me a scholarship to do a diploma in human resource management. So I started studying over the weekend, and during the day, I go around, you know, looking for what to do and stuff like that. So after the first semester, I was the best in class.
Wow.
In the first class. He took me to, when I, as a person who had given him the scholarship, so I had to tell him. So he took me to the director, the program's director then, and said, you know what, this young man, give him something to teach. That's how I started teaching at MDAC. That diploma in human resource management opened my eyes. I realized I had wasted 3 years studying education. I realized there were practical, more real things that were out there to be learned and done. I finished my diploma in 2015 and immediately go for an MBA at Makerere. Wow. That is how I switched from being a teacher, classroom teacher, to a trainer, a consultant, and a financial expert. Most of those things from my MBA, but also a lot more I taught myself. That's how I jump out of the teacher trap. And I think my auntie has never forgiven me until today that I am not in class teaching.
Well, at least you're in class teaching at MTAC. But all this while, you're also going through the other aspects of growing up like any other young man.
Yeah.
You're finding love along the way.
Yeah, I got my girlfriend when we were at school. In senior one, I met her elder sister in the village in Karuel where I was staying. And then when she learned that I was in a school in Barara, she told me, oh, my sister is also in some school in Rukunjiri, in Yachubare. So I said, who? So she told me, she's called Claire. So when she told me the names, skilled me. I went, when I reached Jovok, I sent her a letter, yes. And I called myself Agaba Alex. Because I wasn't sure the response I was going to get. So I wanted to play safe, just in case things backfire.
No one knows.
So she didn't respond to the letter. When I reached campus, When I reached campus in first year, we had an association called Ndorwa East Students Association.
Mm-hmm.
So when we go for the meeting, we introduce ourselves. She introduces herself, and I'm like, okay, this is the girl. So I woke up to her, and I was like, okay, do you remember the young man, the person who sent you a letter, and da-da-da-da, Agaba Alex? She said, yes. I said, I'm the one.
Why didn't you reply the letter?
I started running for the reply, my friend.
Uh-huh.
And the reply is what resulted into love.
But it had to take 6 years.
Yes, to get the reply.
Why didn't she reply to you again?
She was inspired by your
letter.
Naturally, she's a carefree person. She's a person who can see something. If she doesn't pick interest immediately, she'll just ignore. But she'll not forget. So when I told her, she still remembered. And she told me, I actually kept that letter in my father's suitcase. You know, those village men, they have a suitcase where they keep clothes. So it was in that suitcase. And when she said that, in my heart, I was like, okay, this is serious. So we started there, and then we fell in love. And after campus, when we graduated in January 2014, we had a meeting. I called her for a meeting. I told her, you know what? I think for me, But when we started dating in second year, I told her, you know what? I am dating you. I don't want someone just to run around with, but me, I want a wife in you. And she laughed because she didn't think I was serious. This humble young man with no clear family background, yes. But when we met after graduation, I told her, you know what? I want us to start a family. She asked me how.
I had
nothing, but I also did not know how we were supposed to start. But I told her, you know what, me? Let's start. So she asked me, so how should we? I said, I'm going to come to your place, to your home, and I will introduce myself to your family, and then we start off. So she thought I was joking. So in May 2014, four months after graduation, I borrowed some money, 100,000, and I bought a suit in Wanegea of 80,000. And I told my cousin brother, who gave me, I think, 2 crates of beer, and my auntie mobilized her daughter and the husband to the daughter, and off we went to meet the parents of my wife-to-be.
And where?
In Bunamaya. We met them in Bunamaya at the elder brother's home. So we go, and then the normal culture things,
mm-hmm.
and told them, I want to marry.
But you had no serious job.
Nothing, yes, I had nothing. True, I had nothing. But I was convinced that I needed to start a family then. Partly because I didn't want to get drowned into this bachelor life where young men get out of campus, they get some little money, start sleeping, sitting around, blasting and stuff like that.
So for you, it was one bullet, one kill.
Absolutely. And just like that, when I went the following week, I had got a gig in Bujiri. Mm-hmm. I was in the field, and she called me. She said, "You send someone to pick me. I want to come." And I sent my cousin brother. He had a car. He went, picked her. And when I came back, I found her home. And we started the family.
In Wiji?
No, here, in Kampala. I came back. Yeah. I was just going to feed and coming back. So that year, I think in November, we had our first child, Calvin Chokwijuka. And then after a year and a half, we had our second born, Carlos. And then that is the time when I told her, you know what? I want us to wed. That was 2016. And I had just got a job. I had just got a full-time job with MTAC and then as an administrator. So I told her I want us to wed. And we even set the date for the following year.
I'm sure the venue must have been MTAC Gardens.
No.
You decided to save yourself.
I decided save myself and go.
You wanted to wed in an unfamiliar environment.
Exactly. So we did, and I called friends and family and all that. And on 30th of September 2017, we walked down the aisle.
Wow.
And later on, I think a year and a half later, we got our third child. So we are blessed with three.
And still counting?
Well, we're still thinking whether to stop there. So that's how we get there. And when I tell people that I'm officially married with three children, some
at
think
31.
I'm joking. At 31, yes. Some think I'm joking. But it has been an interesting life journey that I can assure you that I don't regret any of the decisions I made, whether in business, whether in life, marriage, and all that, I don't regret. It has helped me grow very fast, that when I'm with my contemporaries, my fellow 31-year-olds, I realize that there is something that, you know...
You have an edge
exactly
over them because you stabilize a lot
absolutely,
earlier.
Absolutely, yeah.
But others will also argue that there is a huge part of life that you've not lived.
That's true. But
which we fear you may suffer from at some point in the future and develop a midlife crisis.
By the grace of God, which has really been evident in my life, I know I will overcome all of that. Yeah.
That's the quintessential postcard story of a boy next door.
Thank you.
And what we hope that all of us could go through.
Yeah.
No matter the circumstances, but just go to school,
yeah.
Get out, find a job, whatever the circumstances. Find love, find a family,
yeah.
And do your hustle
and
bring value to yourself. Today now you're a successful businessman,
yeah.
Successful worker, successful husband,
yeah.
Living in your own house,
yeah.
Trying to go back, redeem your village,
yeah.
And with a clear ambition of what you want to be. But if I may ask, where do we see you in the next 10, 15, 20 years? Certainly on a ballot paper somewhere, I think.
Well, I get that a lot every now and then.
Considering your strong resemblance, your area member of parliament, Winfred Nwaga.
I recently got a challenge. I joined him for his campaign trail.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes when I made a mistake of going ahead of him,
people
would start dancing thinking I'm the one.
Mm.
And even when people start thinking that maybe you're ready to serve, but we are not. But anyway. I love politics, I love business, I love life, because I think those are
the things major that things really matter.
Exactly. I have lived life. I think where I am almost, you know, achieving my private victory. In life, there is what we call public victory. Not just to find relevance, but also to make an effort, an extra mile, to ensure that the person next door is either as good as you are or is not in a dire state.
Mm.
Because once you have a neighbor who is well, then you are well too. So my efforts now are to make sure that I reach out to as many people as I can, especially where I come from. There are very many fronts. I have done non-profit before. In my business, you know, endeavors, I try as much as I can to empower people. But also the political front is also there, because certain things, honestly, require you to be somewhere, because to give you the edge to make decisions and also identify where resources are and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I have considered, you know, contesting for leadership and all that. One thing I know is that sometime in my life, God willing, I will be on a ballot paper somewhere, and not just one, but several of them. My ultimate dream is to become president of this country.
I love your ambition.
Yes. Because when I reach, and I should have told you, my biggest icon is Barack Obama.
After having gone through his fellowship of young
African leaders. And I'm glad I did, because my liking for him, you know, focuses on his humble background and how
the audacity of hope.
Exactly. How he was able to come up and, you know, struggle through life and look where he is. And I believe that any young man with a kind of ambition can actually make it. That's why I told you that there's nothing that beats a humble effort with commitment, love and motivation.
We'll pin this program.
Thank you.
And wait for the time you're president of the land. And whoever will be there at that time, and maybe I'll still be here,
sure.
Old and gray, with a back, with a bent back, still interviewing people for our living.
Sure.
And I'll say, he was here, he told us, see where he is.
Exactly.
Alison, it's been a pleasure having you on the program.
Thank you so much.
Only one question that no one escapes when they sit on that chair.
Okay.
It's a very beautiful country that it is. You were born in your humble village called Chigarama. You have been around possibly in only a few places in this country, Bujiri and others. But if you've had the pleasure of traveling across this country, you realize it's a very beautiful country.
Very.
If one were to give you an opportunity to be marooned somewhere in this country, where would you love that to be and why?
Well, I think I would be glad being in Chigarama.
Back to your cradle.
Yeah.
Look at the undulating hills.
Oh, yeah.
The raging rivers.
Yeah.
And of course, the people so warm.
Exactly.
For you, the listeners and viewers, we never take your presence for granted. We are glad that you could have been doing anything else, but here you are. We thank you for being a part of this program. For you, Alex, we know that your journey to life just began. And we are waiting for you to return to this same dice to have more of this conversation.
Thank you.
Have a wonderful time. Let's meet same place, same time, next Sunday with yet another incredible life story from a folk that has distinguished themselves in what they are doing with a great ambition, as Alex just shared with us here. See ya.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.